next speaker is Omri Barak from the Technion.
Thank you. Hello, and thanks very much for inviting me. I want to speak a bit about local and global memory in echostate networks, and I was actually debating a bit, you'll decide later whether a related issue is structure, randomness, and memory in echostate networks. So, basically, our actions are influenced by things that happened in the past, and therefore we can come to the amazing conclusion that we have memory. And if we have some memory, then we might be interested in how that memory is maintained in neural networks in our brain. And I'm going to present, present a biophysically detailed model. It's called Orange Brain, and this is it. And so this is my model of the brain, and this is my model of the world. And I'm going to use this to present a long-term memory, where a stimulus impinges upon the network, and following that stimulus, there's going to be some persistent, permanent structural change that holds the memory of the stimulus. Now, this is not the only form of memory, of course. Sometimes we learn things, you know, just one shot. We just, for a short while, we don't assume that every stimulus gives us a permanent structural change. And this is what we call working or short-term memory. And this is what I'm going to explore now. Now, this memory has a certain apparent problem, which is, If the memory is maintained by neurons, and we know that neurons operate with spikes. Spikes are very short, fast activity events. They take, they're on the order of milliseconds. Whereas memory is something that, even shorter memory is something that can easily extend to seconds or minutes. And there's this apparent problem that how can we maintain a memory for several seconds or minutes, where the individual elements that are used to maintain this memory operate on the time scale of milliseconds? And a common solution for this apparent discrepancy is to invoke networks of neurons. And there are sort of two scenarios I wish to describe within this context. One is when we have a known stimulus, so something that we saw in the past, and now we see it again. So because this is a known stimulus, then the network is already changed. It has a long-term memory of this stimulus, and now I present it again. So once I present the stimulus again, it will cause some activity in the network to be invoked. And this activity, what we usually term an attractor, it will be determined by the long-term trace, and the common assumption is that recurrent excitation helps maintain this activity. Again, so we have this millisecond activity that is maintained throughout recurrent excitation. Another scenario I'm interested in is when we have a novel stimulus. So now the structure of the network does not reflect this stimulus, but yet, when the stimulus comes, it will excite the network. And then we will have some transient excitation that will eventually fade away. So these are sort of two forms of memory that I'm interested in. And in both cases, the sort of the long memory, the memory beyond a few milliseconds, is a property of the network. It is an emergent network phenomenon. So the network is able, by virtue of the large number of elements, the network is able to stretch the milliseconds of the individual neuron into the seconds or minutes required to perform tasks. And I want to now look a bit at some data to try and contrast between these two methods of looking at known versus novel stimuli, transient versus attractors, and also later about stretching the milliseconds to seconds. So I'm going to describe some data analysis from the lab of Ranulfo Romo. This is recordings from dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and the task is as follows. A monkey is presented with a tactile stimulus, so this mechanical vibrator, and then at a certain point there's a vibration of a given frequency, F1, then there is a delay of a few seconds, and then there is a second stimulus, F2. And the task of the monkey is to signal via button press whether the first stimulus is, the frequency of the first stimulus is larger than that of the second one. And in order to solve such a task, one might expect that you somehow need to encode an analog variable in memory, which is the frequency of the first stimulus. Then you need to keep this encoded value in memory for a few seconds. And finally, you have to do math. You have to sort of subtract one from the other. And this task that the monkeys are doing it for months and months, and it makes sense to think that this is sort of the known stimulus case. So it makes sense to think that in long-term memory, there is already some template or schema of this task, and an attractor has been formed so that when the stimulus appears, when the first stimulus appears to the monkey, it will be maintained in memory through this recurrent excitation. And many models have been proposed. This is one of them by Mackens and Brody, where there is this recurrent excitation. In this case, there's also inhibitory neurons, and they're positively and negatively tuned neurons, and they excite each other and inhibit the other group. And this is a very elegant model that shows how you can implement such an attractor framework. And the basic thing you can see, so here the x-axis is time, y-axis is the firing rate of a neuron, and the different colors correspond to different frequencies of the first stimulus. And what you can see is that this neuron in the model monotonically, its firing rate is monotonically dependent on the stimulus frequency, and this tendency is maintained throughout the delay period, thereby keeping the memory in an attractor. And when you go and look on the actual data, then what you can see is there are indeed neurons that seem to be consistent with this hypothesis. So this is a neuron, again, time, firing rate, and color codes the frequency of the first stimulus, that during the first stimulus, there is a monotonic, a positive monotonic encoding of the stimulus frequency by the neuron's firing rate. And this is also shown here, stimulus frequency, neuron firing rate during the stimulus. And the tendency is maintained throughout the delay period. So it's not exactly a straight line like the model, but no, this is data, it's not a model. And there are other neurons. Okay, so there are other neurons that that have it, the same sort of consistency, but have a negative tuning. So here, the firing rate of the neuron is decreased as a function of stimulus frequency, and that, in this specific task, that might be very useful, because at the end of the day, you need to do this math. You need to subtract F1 minus F2, so if you have negative neurons and positive neurons, it might help do that. So these two neurons are very consistent with the attractor hypothesis, but there are other neurons as well. So there are neurons where you can see that the tuning is not neither positive nor negative. It's not monotonic. And there are neurons that are negative during the stimulus, but positive during the delay. Okay, now of course it's a problem. I mean, the attractor model shows you their favorite neurons, and I'm showing you my favorite neurons, and you know it's hard to know who to believe. So these are all the neurons that were in this study, and I'm showing the tuning during the stimulus compared to the tuning during the delay. And usually there is a correlation, there is a positive correlation, but you know, about a third of them switch signs between positive and negative tuning. So overall, it's not the typical neuron is not consistent throughout the different task epochs. And since there have been other works of other groups in different tasks in different regions showing similar findings. Yeah.
Could you imagine a more rich attractor model where you would have tuning curves which are non-monotonic and also maybe the inputs to the system are such that some neurons receive an input which is not consistent with their own activity in the attractor state?
It could be. I mean, this is the... It could be, for instance, first of all, the fact that a neuron is not monotonic is certainly not, you know, strong evidence against the attractor model. It's you could say it's an evidence against the simple version proposed in the model. As for the fact that that the tuning switches sort of between the different task epochs, again, it could be that that you sort of go into a certain point in phase space, and then when you relax to the attractor, then it's sort of a nonlinear change, and then you maintain. And the data is I can say it's certainly more consistent of such a description than the constant description, but it's there are also some holes in that as well and I will show it later on. So the model, I'm now going to present, in a sense, the other end of the spectrum. So there's on one end, there is a very highly organized, structured attractor network that can solve the task. And I'm going to show the complete opposite, which is a completely random, chaotic network that can still solve the task. So what is this network? This is from the framework of echo state or liquid state or reservoir computing. And the basic idea is that the internal dynamics of the network do not have to be tuned to the task. They simply have to be rich enough. And as an example, you can think of walking in a forest and leaving footprints. And I can later come on and examine your footprints and deduce where you've been. And of course, the forest was not designed in any way to track your footprints. It's just a complex physical system. Sorry. In the same way, a complex enough physical system like a recurrent neural network might hold enough information on the stimulus history so that a plausible readout can later utilize that. And that's the concept here. So these are firing rate neurons, point neurons, sigmoid activity, continuous time, and the connectivity is completely random with a simple hyperbolic tangent nonlinearity, as abstract as they get. And now I'm going to implement the task. So I'm going to have inputs. So some of the neurons, like this neuron here, are going to receive increasing input with increasing stimulus frequency, and others are going to get this decreasing input. So there are going to be positive and negative neurons, but this is just the input they get. The connectivity does not respect the input in any sense. It has no relation to it whatsoever. And so random means it has nothing to do with the task. And chaotic means that the gain, the connectivity is large, the gain is high, so that the network is in a chaotic state. And the only training I'm going to do is the readout. I'm not going to affect the dynamics. Okay? So, again, chaotic, and also there's no reset. So I'm not starting the system from a predefined initial state. I'm starting the system from a variable delay between the trials. And that means I'm going to encounter the system in a different place in the strange attractor, if you will, at every trial. So there's this chaotic activity, and also during the stimulus you might say that the stimulus is an input. And if you take a chaotic network like this and you give it external input, the input can take it out of the chaotic regime. But during the delay period or between the trials, there is no input. So it is in the chaotic regime. And so here's a typical, really this is just neuron number one, neuron. And so there are two, the red and the blue represent two different conditions. Both have the same F2 frequency and different F1. And these are 20 different trials. So it's a mess. And so the initial condition is very varied. You can see that the stimulus is strong, but it's still quite a mess. And again, the stimulus cannot be too strong, because if it's very strong, then the second stimulus will erase all information on the first one. So it has to be strong enough to somehow repress this initial variability, but not too strong so as not to destroy this information. Yeah.
So is it fair to assume that there is no stimulus between the two frequency?
No, of course, you know, the world did not evaporate during these two things, but there's a very salient perturbation, and then there's nothing, and then there's a silent perturbation again. Of course, you know, that you can still hear something, but there's a huge contrast in the stimulus between this period and this period.
There's also training.
There is no training here. This is just the activity of one neuron when being presented from the stimulus, but the training does not affect the activity of any neuron. The training is just a readout of many, of 1500 neurons like this. And the question is, can you tell apart the red and the blue, right? Because one is F1 small and one is F1 large. So can you tell apart the red and the blue? Obviously from this neuron you cannot, but from a population of them, you can.
Yeah. So again, how exactly do you model the input to the neuron? Does this neuron receive an input?
Yes, so it receives an input here, which is monotonic in the frequency.
Is it just current in your model, or?
I'm not sure if I put it, but it's, okay, I didn't put it, plus bias term, which is the input.
Which is just proportional to the frequency.
Yeah, exactly.
And all neurons receive the same input.
Everyone has a different slope, a random slope.
So, but
I think maybe just a 30% receive input and 70% don't.
Okay.
And
then if this is really difficult, if you go back, if this is really difficult, then the neuron doesn't code the frequency of the first of the red versus the blue during the interval. If you look at the middle,
yes,
you have a very nice separation. So
yes,
there is an effect, different effects of the two stimuli, but
of
you
otherwise,
them
if there was no memory, then
but
you know,
it
wouldn't
contribute to the whole network.
Again, it's what I'm saying is exactly this. If you take a random network and you give a strong stimulus to it, it will leave an effect. That's the whole point.
Different effects for different stimuli. And
yeah.
So stimuli numbers, they have a feedback term.
Here not.
I think if you take a random network in the chaotic state, you don't have it, otherwise it would decay very quickly.
Yes, depending on the size. Okay, so I'm just going to show that, so now I'm going to present, let's say, one condition which is F1 larger than F2, and you can see the output. Again, the output is just a linear combination of the activity of all neurons, and it's going to be here. And then for a case where F2 is the larger one, then the activity following, the output following the second stimulus, which is the way I define the task, I only demanded what's going to happen here, is positive. And then I can repeat this for many, 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 many cases. And I can get so these are sort of the experimental conditions. And I can see that it performs the task on the same level of accuracy as the experiment, which is just how I tuned it.
I chose enough neuron, enough noise to sort of, to do this. Yeah.
Why do you care so much about the strength of the input, or why do you have your neurons on the side in the second input? I mean, it's enough to have a network that stores in memory the first one, and then when you get a second, you ask separately what you have in memory is above or beneath.
I didn't want to deal with mechanism, what they mean by store, I have a task that implicitly requires you to store something in the memory and then perform a computation based on that.
Yeah.
So if the network performs it, then apparently it had a memory. But I didn't want to specify exactly how to keep this memory. In a sense, because I'm only asking here, the fact that I ask just, be negative or positive, and I did not ask output a very specific waveform, for instance, is a way for me to just ask, did you store these two memories, and not much more than that. I actually, that's on purpose. I did not want a waveform here, which is, by the way, what the reason that I did not use the force algorithm for this, because I didn't want to confound it.
Presented as if it's like if the system is rich enough, then it kind of stores the memory, but it has to be this, it's not enough to be thought, it has to be sound structure, otherwise every time it will be thrown away to a random place, there will be no correlation.
But you give the same stimulus.
You give the same stimulus, which means that you drive the system to some subspace that has some consistency.
But that's just, okay, so think of it, it's a chaotic network, right? So in principle, it means that the initial condition is somewhere in a very large space of the strange attractor. And I'm presenting the first stimulus. Now, had I presented the first stimulus for a very long time, a very strong stimulus, it would drive the network out of chaos. So it would go to this point in space. I didn't, right? So it's in a sort of ball around this point in space, which depends on where I started, my initial condition. But still, for one stimulus it's here, and for another stimulus it's there. So I have some information, very noisy information. And apparently it's enough, and then I let it diverge into chaos for another, it's 30 time steps of the simulation. So it would go out into the strange attractor, but apparently the strange attractor is large enough, and I didn't wait too long, so it's still related to where I came from, and then I do the same thing again, and enough is retained.
The question is, how sensitive is your W window rate to the fact that you make a flat to 2.5 seconds, or is more talking a small buffer?
So here I had, I think this is 30 time steps plus minus 7, and trial interval is 100 and something plus minus 30, so I have some levels of noise, for instance, like how much I vary this. So it has some robustness, and again, I'm going to speak about this. This is 1500 neurons. It would not work with 100 neurons. And
some classes of attractor state like neurons.
So in this, there is not going to be an attractor like. But okay, I'm going to show. Okay, I'm going to show you. Okay, so. So this, so I just showed you that that I can, again, this attractor, one end of the spectrum, an attractor model can work, and at the other end, a completely chaotic thing can also work. And now, but does this chaotic thing look anything remotely like the data? So if I search very hard, okay, just sort the neurons according to their attractoriness, I can find these nice neurons in the chaotic networks. Okay, but I know that that in a sense it's just by chance that they are not relied on, and I don't have the data, but I did try to sort of remove some of them. It's not, I mean, they're not special in any way in the functional. So that you can find these nice neurons and this sort of mess, more messy neurons. But I wanted something a bit more systematic to see where the data lies between this. Structured and random networks, and what I used as a measure is the consistency of tuning according to the task epochs. where you can see that the sort of between the stimulus and the delay, there is a weak correlation, but within the delay, between different parts of the delay, there is a much stronger correlation. This is the data, I think. Okay, and then I can sort of plot this across time. But basically, it's consistent within the delay. It's not consistent between different epochs.
Which data? The experiment?
Yes, the experiment. And now, if I look at the if I look at the attractor model, then it's perfect between the stimulus and delay. It's perfect within the delay. If I look at my chaotic random model, it's a complete mess here and it's a complete mess there. You can see that it sort of decorrelates very, very fast, much faster than the data. Yeah.
So this relates to the question I wanted to ask. If you train it to do the discrimination or the task at some particular time, 3 seconds after the stimulus, will it, how robust, I mean, will it, if you wanted to do it 4 seconds afterwards, would it still be?
So in general, the network will interpolate and not extrapolate. So if I this training, the training is not on the dynamics, it's just the readout.
Right.
So if I train it between 2 and 5 seconds, then it will also work for 3 and 4 and 4.5. But it will probably fail on 7, it will go for 5.5, but it will drop. It will not extrapolate.
The training, what's the delta T on training? So it would enter 2, 4, and 6, it would probably not generalize to 3 or weak.
I didn't check it very systematically, but in general it interpolates not bad. I mean, I on the F1, F2 plane, I did it quite a lot, where I just sort of sampled a grid of F1, F2, and it interpolated perfectly.
No,
the
F1, F2 is not...
Time? I'm not sure it's so different. So from the things I did try with time, so there was another task which was had only time. The task was just to produce time, so that you get two signals and you have to produce an output from the same interval, and that interpolated perfectly in time. And again, did not extrapolate. So interpolation in general, everything is continuous.
But
is
it possible that you have a very wide range of time, eventually the training picks the specific 10 or 20% of neurons that look like a nice readout cell, like in the nice network.
And probably if I want a very large range, I need a ridiculously large number of neurons. But I don't think there is anything apart from that. So,
the readout was just using a linear regression?
Perceptron.
Okay, and there is no noise in this region.
So here I didn't put noise because there was the chaos provided tons of variability. But, so another sort of between these two extreme cases, because the data does not look like either one of these. So we also wanted to find an intermediate case, and the intermediate, what we did is we started with this scenario, but then trained, this wasn't with the feedback, it's a Hessian tree, it trains all the recurrent weights, but basically it's the same thing, but then you train all of these connections. Very similar results were found when we used the force as well, but since we had to specify a waveform, we did not want to use. And then you get something that looks a lot more like an attractor, still has also non-attractor cells. And you can see that if we look at the data, and then there's the attractor network and the random network, then this train, the one that started random and had some training to the task, looks a lot more similar to the data. I'm not saying that this is exactly the data, but it looks a lot more like the data. Again, there's inconsistency between epochs, there is a lot more consistency within epochs.
How do you train the data?
You just train it on like the perceptron, it's a Hessian free training. So it's all you have to specify is like the perceptron, that you want it to be positive for something and negative for another. And basically that propagation through time, that works.
So you don't specify the activity of the recap.
No, no, just an output. Just an out. It's an output, but you train all the way, not just the output. It's part of question for time, but it's the Hessian tree makes it work and not explode vanish on the things that usually recover on the books or not. Okay, so what I showed you is that the same task can be solved in sort of very different ways. One is this attractor structured way, another is the chaotic random way, and the data seems more consistent with an intermediate case. And now, of course, I'm lying to you, you know, just like standing here, because I mean, one thing that's obvious is that there is an advantage to the structured case. Of course, if you build a system that is, you know, well tailored to one task, it will do it better than this random thing. And just to show here, this attractor network has 40 spiking neurons, and the chaotic one 1,500 rate neurons. So this is like an amazingly inefficient way to perform the task. The task was rather simple, so I could perform it even with this chaotic, no reset, you know, random network.
When you say that it has 1,500, it means that it didn't work for 150 neurons, the chaotic?
I didn't, for 150, I'm sure it will not work. I didn't do it very systematically. Basically, I modified this a bit just to match the performance of all the networks. But it certainly would not work with 100 or 200 in this case.
What is it? It actually is not a frequency difference. Can you call different frequencies? F1.
The resolution, you mean? The F1, F2?
Yeah.
So the experiment has 10 frequency pairs. And some choice, of course, with the scaling of it arbitrary. But I calibrated the network to have. I mapped the frequency to the input space of the network, and then I chose these 10 frequencies, and I matched the performance of all the networks to the experimental data, which was 95% or 94%.
Can you explain
what
is
what
Hessian-free?
No. it's a machine learning algorithm. You can there's on Coursera, there's a 8-minute lecture by Hinton that explains the basics of it, which is very nice, I recommend it. There's a few tutorials, to be honest. It's a machine learning algorithm portraying all the recurrent rates of the network to produce a specified output. And the output does not have to be specified for all time, you can specify it only for the end point and not specify what you want for the entire way.
The usual problems of
that
problem, like
also
minima,
has been
say why.
Again, so I don't want to sort of go into that, but it's a conjugate gradient, basically, that you sort of make large steps, and you use
I don't mean the algorithm, I mean, this algorithm doesn't have local options, right? You're talking about why, because of the architecture,
No, the algorithm is sort of more precise than the naive. It makes the corrections are based on the curvature of the cost function
that's
keep it in check. Globally, I don't think it's convex, no.
Right, so I'm wondering why when you train this system, you get
the
result despite
the non-convexity?
Yeah.
I think there was a lot, the solution space is big intuitively, but I don't know. I think there are many ways to solve it. Yeah, it's a simple task. Okay, so the fact that I had to use 1,500 neurons shouldn't come as a surprise. There's a large body of literature that analyzed these echo state similar things to these echo state networks. So there are some analysis on linear networks, either in discrete time or also in continuous time. There's an analysis of sort of very nonlinear, so not sigmoid, but step function nonlinearities in discrete time. And do a very unfair summary of this body of literature, if there are some strong feed-forward or organized structured component, the memory of the network can scale linearly with the size of it. If you just randomly put the connection, it will be horrible. You'll get the logarithmic scaling in the network size. And all of these were usually used by white noise, not exactly by the same single sided, but this is sort of a rough summary of the literature. And the thing is that the people, very distinguished people that did all of these works had a severe disadvantage over me. They were in the physics department mostly, and I'm in the medical school. So I get to use a syringe. And what you could do with the syringe is you can inject a very large tau into the system. Just, you know, why bother with scaling? We can just add another time constant. And the reason I'm going to do that, besides the fun of it, is that neurons have many time scales. Okay, so I started by saying that neurons have these millisecond action potentials, and the network somehow has to stretch them, but you know, neurons have other properties. Neurons have many, many forms of adaptation. This, you know, people from Shimon Norman and Ferrol and Lulowski, there are many works showing that neurons have many, many times because of adaptation. This is just one showing that from Federhol's lab that you switch the input to a neuron and you watch this, how much time it takes it to adapt. And you see that the longer you stimulate it, the longer it takes it to adapt. So the time scale is proportional to the stimulation period, which means that there are many processes, many time scales in the neuron. So neurons have lots of time scales. I'm going to pick one now. Let's say synaptic depression. I'm going to take my original network and do some version of the Zodiac's marker model, which basically means that instead of having the normal hyperbolic tangent, then I'm going to scale it down by some resource variable. So it's going to decrease with activity. And then after some time, some tau y, some characteristic time scale, it's going to slowly increase back. So there's going to be some resource variable with a time scale that is potentially much slower than the firing dynamics. Okay, that's synaptic, some form of synaptic depression. And likewise, I can have facilitation that will mean that I'm now going to be plus. So this is going to increase with activity. So I can also have another model that has tau injected in, that has a long time scale. Now what happens when I do these tricks? So I'm going to take a task, delayed match to sample in this case. I'm going to have two stimuli, which are simply two random input vectors into the network, separated by some time. And then the network has to say at this point in time whether it was same or different, AABB or ABBA. Again, it has to maintain the memory long enough to perform the task. Now, how does it perform? So if the time constant, the depression time constant is zero, then performance is chance level. This is a small network of 100 neurons, the delay is 17 time constants, and the gain is one, some parameters, it's not really important. Not very crucial for this point. What I'm showing is that as you increase this slow component, the adaptation, the time scale of recovery from adaptation, then the network, this ecostate, is able to utilize this slow information and increase the performance as you increase this tau.
This is arbitrary.
So this is saying that the tau of the single neuron is 1.
The tau of the single neuron is 1 and the delay in the task is 17.
It's 17, yeah.
So it takes until tau is like twice as big as the delay.
To start to perform. Yeah, I want to sort of, you know, sign that this is a general. But now, the thing is that I can go on. And if I go on, then performance starts deteriorating. So, you know, it was great putting this large tau up to here, I was very happy, but when tau gets larger and larger, suddenly performance deteriorates. And if I look at this was depression, if I look at facilitation, the same tau, but you know, different non-linearity, then it's a different, you know, it's a different profile, but you could say that qualitatively something similar happens here. That initially it improves performance a lot, but eventually degrades. Now, you know, what have the Romans done for us? So when I put tau, then I lengthened the memory, and I was able to solve tasks. And this works both for the question for facilitation. You could say, oh, it's completely trivial, but you know, I didn't put it in the neural dynamics themselves. It's some hidden variable that holds the slow memory, but I can extract it from the visible, from the activity. What I wanted to focus actually is the fact that a large tau can be detrimental. And why do I care about the fact that a large tau can be detrimental? The reason is that it might seem that I simply move the problem elsewhere, but actually it's a different problem, because in the real world I don't take a task and then say, oh, let's take this neuron and give it the tau I need for the task. I just told you that the neuron has lots and lots and lots of time scales, including very long ones, including too long ones that are detrimental. So now, if you know, I happily injected tau into the system, now it's backfiring at me. So how can I avoid the detrimental effects that different for tasks that have different temporal demands? And what I have again is, you know, networks to the rescue. So perhaps if the neurons, the individual neurons, already have long memory, then what the network does is not stretch the milliseconds into seconds and minutes, but simply select the timescales that are already there in the single neurons for a given task. So can a network select a timescale from its constituents? And to demonstrate this, I'm going to show a task that stores the standard the standard memory task. So I have a network that receives, it's not white noise because this is continuous time, so it's colored noise. It receives some noise, and the output is a shifted version of this noise. And what I'm going to do is actually train, I'm going to test the network. And you can see that as I try to reconstruct further into the past, performance degrades. Okay? And now I'm going to train a network on this specific task. Here I'm going to use the force algorithm because I do have a specific waveform, so it's easy. So I'm going to train a network for a specific delay and then test it. This, by the way, is a network without any time scales, normal rate network. And what happens is that I'm going now to train it for five time steps delay, and you can see that I sort of selectively modify this memory curve of the function. And if I train it for a different delay, then I make another sort of the memory curve shifts in relation with what I trained it for. So I get, so by changing the connectivity of the network in a according to the task, I generate a memory which is suitable to my task.
Why suitable?
Okay, so it's not exactly, it's not one to one. You can see that sort of the so green is the delay 5. You can see that the deviation between the this is the wrong legend, I think. No, okay, so in most of them the deviation starts it's the wrong legend. So this is the 5 and this is the 10. And so the deviation starts around, more or less around this. It's never exactly on 5 and 10, but it's always monotonic. So it's always the deviation of the memory curve for 5 starts before the 1 for 10.
The red is above the green, the dependency of the labeling.
The red is here above
five
and here below. The red is the memory curve for training in 5. And you see that it's better performance on the short time scale and worse performance on the longer time scale.
But it's also better compared to 10.
It's better compared to nothing.
Better compared to 10.
So again, this is, you will say, right? So this is naive.
Yeah.
And in the short, if I said this is in the short, in the specific training,
yeah.
Here. Yeah, okay, so this training is far from optimal. All I wanted to show here is that it's sort of the, it could be that I try to train 10 and I get 15, or I try to get 5, and what I want to show is the monotonic relation. And that I can tell you that this I repeated many, many times, and in all cases, when you do the 5 and 10, consistently, then you get this 5 training gives you a boost in early memory related to the 10 training. So the correspondence between the actual numbers 5 and 10 is never perfect, but the relationship between them and what they do to the memory curve is very consistent.
The readout is straight for every delay, right? For every delay, the exception.
When I'm testing, I'm making the optimal readout for every delay. It's just a bizarre,
you
actually don't have to do. But when I'm training for one specific delay. And just what you can also see, if I now inject the noise in a different input, so the network has a certain input connectivity. If I now inject the noise with a different input, then nothing happens. Then the performance is, so the trained networks, if I now inject it with a different input, then they don't have this improvement. So it was specific to a given input line. And if I now, so the whole point was I started with this long time scale, if I now take a facilitation with a long time scale, the same, same inverse, yeah. Okay, so the same qualitative behavior is also there when I train networks with slow hidden states. And now, the reason I started this whole thing is in the delayed batch to sample task, I had this detrimental effect of the time scale, so I'm afraid I don't have a fantastic improvement, but I do have some. So I take this task, then I take another task, right, this white noise, this colored noise task, and train on it, and then test again with the delayed batch to sample, and you can see that the areas that actually I care more about in this context, the long tau, do get consistently better. So performance improves. This is far from optimal. I can't say that I took this network and brought it up to the maximum. I didn't take the 200 and bring it to the level of the 50. But it did consistently improve the performance. So I was able to sort of overcome some of the detrimental effects that long time scales have by using the network. Okay, how much time do I have?
15 minutes.
Okay, yes.
Can you go one slide?
Yeah.
A very naive view of what's going on here, because you generalize the scenario very a lot, and I'm not sure if I can follow this generalization, but from a very naive point of view, if you have this question, and you basically have this resource variable and you have very, very long time points, and basically after a while the network doesn't have any synapses to work with. Or if you have facilitation, then your network is probably going to epilepsy because it just cannot do anything.
So first of all, the network is not going to be epileptic because due to my extremely biological realistic modeling, JIJ is IID, the amount of effect or inhibitory, so the network in effect is always balanced but yes, you can reach saturation event. You can reach saturation for all sorts of things, and that might be what's happening here. When you have these very, very slow recoveries, then that might be what's happening. But at least partially, you can overcome this. And I'm going to mention another way out of this problem.
So everything is in unit of tau, of the time constant of tau is 1.
Yes, yeah.
So now if you want to make it matching with the data, so which tau is it?
So if you want to make it really matching with the data, if you look at the results that I mentioned, then then you need a power law at the station, and actually not any one tau, because tau depends on stimulus. So actually, you have all of them in a sense. I mean, this is having just one slow process with one specific tau given by the number here. And the green neurons have either, you can say, it's a power law, that there are no time scales, or many processes, many time scales, but they have all of them, right? If you can show single neurons that have hours of patients, not a single channel. Here?
Yeah.
Yeah, I trained it, I think, for 20, for something similar to the delay here. If you try to train it for the ones where, you already have no memory, then you simply fail and nothing happens.
So you can't train.
You cannot train it for this.
No.
You know, with my simple training, I didn't make any effort with the training. Okay, so now I want to, 10 minutes or so. So I want to briefly mention another aspect to this whole thing, which is a black box problem, that in both of the cases, the structured random in the ROMO task, we have this intermediate network that seems more consistent with the data, that you start random and then you train a bit. And also here, we have this long time scale, but then if you train, you can overcome some of the detrimental effects. And in general, you might think that actually it makes some sense, because if you now have the new task to learn, then initially your brain, you could say, is random with respect to that task, because it's a new task. So it makes sense that we are able to perform in this sort of random state, but we'll get better with time. So in that sense, it might be nice to work with these intermediate, these trained networks, that we start with something random and then we train. But unlike the attractor networks, that we really understand how they work, here there are networks that we specify what to do, but we don't know how to do it. So at the end of the day, we have a black box. So we have this network that might seem a bit like the data, but we have no clue how it works. Does it really rely on the same attractor principles, or the feed-forward principles, or is it just some arbitrary classifier? So what we did to approach this is to realize that a recurrent neural network is a nonlinear dynamical system, which is just a fancy way of saying that we don't know about it. But what we do know to do with nonlinear systems is we sort of take different regions of the space and we study them separately. And usually what we do is we take regions that are near fixed points and we linearize around the fixed points, and then we get some hints of what's going on. So why fixed points? I have to put lots of equations now, it's a theory workshop. So if we have x dot is f of x, so the dynamics of x is some function of x. I can take a Taylor approximation of that, and a fixed point is one where f of x is zero. So the zero order term vanishes, and the first order term dominates. And this is the Jacobian, this is how we linearize and we know stability and everything. But what if this term is actually not zero, but it's very small? So if it's very small, and to make sense, you know, how small? So again, this term is small. So what I mean by small is I mean that this term, dx included, is larger. And this term, dx included, is larger. So I can sort of guess it wasn't cut. Some condition for dx. So if f of x is small, then maybe linearizing still makes a bit of sense. Okay? So I'm now ignoring, you know, dx, of course, tells us it's as small as you want. So I don't want trivial small as you want. Let's let it be small, but not as small as you want. I'm happy with that. So the condition to linearize away from a fixed, from some arbitrary point is this. That this f is, if f is zero, then of course that happens. But actually, if it's not a fixed point completely, if f of x is small, it might also make sense to linearize.
What
so, so I have a point, a candidate point. I'm not saying whether it's a fixed point or it's a candidate point in space space. And I want to look at the behavior around this point. If this point is a fixed point, then I can look at all the area around it and have a rigorous mathematical sense of saying that it is dominated by the linear term. If f of x is not zero, I can have a ring torus, in a sense, around this point, that it still makes sense to talk about the linear term.
About
the linear system. In a torus around it, I'm not going very near, because then of course I cannot because f is not zero.
If not zero, it's on torus.
And say f is not zero. So of course there exists a dx which is very, very small, for which maybe the things are you know, maybe things are, it could be that so in a sense the f will dominate then. Okay, the zero of the term will dominate if dx is very small, not the linear. What I'm saying
what
is that
it's sign.
Sign. What?
Sign. Is it positive or negative? The f double x. The
there's a magnitude.
What?
It's all of it is vectors, so it's a norm. This is the quite hand wavy to do this because this is a matrix and the matrices and but what I'm saying is that in general if you have a Taylor approximation, then if the zero order term is small but non-zero, it might still make I'll show you a case where you can get some insight when we linearize around the non-fixed point. Okay, in a few steps. Okay, so how do I find this point? I take the norm and I take this f of x and I want it to be small. I take an auxiliary function, which is the norm of the dynamics, or the velocity, you might say, or kinetic energy. And x is the f of x is the dynamics. And this is zero if and only if x is a fixed point. And now I have what I can do is just take somewhere where I suspect there might be a fixed point or some interesting point in the dynamics, and do a gradient descent on this scalar function, because it's a scalar, I can do it. Now, the nice thing about it is that in general fixed points, if they're stable or unstable, then I can find, if they're completely stable or completely unstable, I can find them just by running the dynamics. But if I have something that is almost stable, like a saddle point that has a negative eigenvalue and a positive eigenvalue, the dynamics will never get me there. But this method can get me there, and a saddle might be important because it might be in an area that separates two very different behaviors of the dynamics. A decision plane is characterized by a saddle. So this example, I hope, will clarify what's going on. This is some 2D dynamics, nonlinear, three fixed points, two stable fixed points and a saddle point. So the black trajectories are the dynamics that will never get to the saddle, but will always run to one of the two fixed points. And the contour lines are this Q, the norm of the dynamics. So what happens is if I do a gradient descent on the norm of the dynamics from a trajectory, so the trajectory will go to the fixed point, to the stable fixed point, but going on the norm of the dynamics will lead me to the saddle point. And of course, in 2D, I could just find it. But in 1,000 dimensions, it's a technique to find the saddle point. But otherwise, I cannot. And I'll go a bit. I just showed two concepts here. So this is just we train the network that has a 3-bit memory.
I think it would be helpful if you. I don't understand if you're presenting us with a mathematical tool to do things. Or you're telling me something about properties of
networks. Okay, so this is a mathematical tool, and the reason I want this mathematical tool is because when I looked at networks, I saw that completely structured networks can solve tasks that the brain does, and completely random networks can do the same. The data do not match either of them. when I take a random network and I train it, I get a network that is more similar to the data than either end of the extreme. The problem is that now I'm left with a network that can do the task, but I have no clue what are the mechanisms of this network. And it might be nice to have a tool that can reverse engineer this network that I trained. So if I can train networks to match the data on some aspect, but the resulting thing in network is a black box, I don't know how it works, now I want a mathematical tool to open the black box.
I don't understand what you mean by black box. I have all the equations, I have all the...
Yes, so you have a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix.
Okay.
But I want to, so here is a 3-bit memory. Does it use fixed points to store memory? Does it use saddle points of 10 eigenvalues, positive eigenvalues to move between 5, 1, 6 points and the other?
So
is there a limit cycle? I mean, there are some dynamics.
You're trying to find a way of approximating the dynamics.
For instance, I want to, when I build a network with a tractor, I know how the dynamical plane looks like, the space looks like. When I train it, I don't know how it works. So maybe I can get, you know, maybe I can gain some insight from opening these trained networks and see, so taking a network, training it to match the data, and then looking how it works. Maybe it will be, you know, an exercise that gives you nothing, but maybe and again, here, I can, of course, here I'm using the full 1,000 by 1,000 connectivity matrix. Hopefully, some of these things like fixed points might be found from trajectories or perturbed trajectories, and then I can use them on directly on data. But here I'm just saying this is a tool to make sense of these networks that I trained, and I don't know what they do, how they do things. Half okay is good for this stage to talk.
But how does this react to the fact that f is not zero?
Okay, so here's the f is going to be, two slides. Okay, so I'm just going to give two examples. So here there is a network, again, training is a recurrent network to perform a 3-bit memory. It has pulses and it needs to remember the last pulse. And then using this technique, we actually find, this is a PCA space of the network, and we find 8 fixed points corresponding to the 2 to 3 possible memory states. We find saddle points that have, this is a 1,000-dimensional space, 999 stable eigenvalues, 1 unstable eigenvalue. This 1 unstable eigenvalue leads to these 2 different fixed points. So you can say it mediates the decision between these two things. If we zoom into one of them, we can sort of see how these two things with the saddle point in between, how the transition from the input to the, from when I give a pulse from one state to the other, that the saddle point sort of mediates this transition. If I give a weaker amplitude, then at some point I go back through this saddle point. So this is just showing that we can, you know, this is a very artificial sense, but take a network that I tell it what to do, and later extract how it did it using these techniques.
Where does the analysis of the
saddle
point come from? You just
did
it here, right? So
I took all of the trajectories of the network from each from sample of the point on the trajectories. I started a gradient descent on the norm of the dynamics. When it reached a fixed point, I linearized around it and saw how many eigenvalues are positive and negative. And that's how I find the saddle point. Otherwise, I never run into this point, just where I'm in the dynamics. And again,
this is the
basketball
network, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Here, the solution found was in a basketball network.
But the fixed points themselves you could find by running the dynamics.
The fixed point, the stable fixed point, yes. The
you already knew that there are 8 stable fixed points, and your method allowed you also to find.
Yes, and now I'm going to show you where I have a case where that's not true. So, for instance, what happens if I have the following two-dimensional example? The green lines are null lines. Some dynamics, 2D dynamics, and the greens are the 2 null lines. They intersect at 2 points. So there are 2 fixed points. One is attractive, one is a saddle. And the black lines are the dynamics. And if I run my algorithm, it will find these 2 fixed points. Now, if I pull the green lines away, at some point they will not intersect anymore. No fixed points at all. If I run the algorithm, it will find a local minimum of the norm of the dynamics. This is not a fixed point. This is not a global. This is a local minimum. I can also show that the local minimum means that the flow is a zero eigenvector of the Jacobian. This sort of comes out from the map. And what this means is that here, if I linearize, okay, I linearized around the non-fixed point, then the linearization shows a negative eigenvalue and a zero eigenvalue. The true dynamics is very much a negative, but instead of a zero, the fact that I have a non-fixed point, I have an actual flow, there's a very, very slow motion along this zero eigenvalue. So this is the case where I linearized around the non-fixed point, but I still gained valuable intuition about this channel, that all of the dynamics flows through this channel, and I can understand how it works. And just a final sort of way of a network that has no fixed point. Actually, I think it had two. The task doesn't really matter what the task is here. It's an artificial task that requires storing two items in memory, two analog numbers in memory. Again, random network, trained to do this task, solves it. So if there are two items, two analog values in memory at all time, there should be a plane attractor, intuitively, that corresponds to these two numbers. Now, using this technique, we found, I think, one or maybe two fixed points. But if we now limit ourselves not to finding an absolute global minimum, but a contour line, an area where the norm is very, very, very small. Non-zero, not even a local minimum. But just areas where the norm is 10 to the minus 8 or some contour lines, then we can find a manifold, a two-dimensional manifold, that corresponds to all of these points. So it's not a plane attractor, it's an almost plane attractor, but we can still find it. And again, the dynamic, so you can say the dynamics also sort of, in this case, you hover around this quite a lot, so, but it allows you to go sort of beyond fixed points. And again, so I can locate it, it allows to understand the mechanisms. And just a word about these you know, fixed points are nice, but in a sense, they're not necessary. A train network has to be good enough, not perfect. And what happens is if you have, first of all, if you have noise, then maybe you can't even tell it apart. A case of you know, null lines that are like this or like that. Maybe, you know, noise will not even discern between them. So it's good that you're not, if you have a plane attractor and you now, I now perturb all of the weights, I add noise, then this approximate plane attractor looks the same. If I had an exact plane attractor, that requires fine tuning. If I perturb it, then it will probably become an approximate plane attractor. So,
what exactly do you mean by approximate plane attractor?
Because this was a plane or a manifold of almost 6 points. None of them are 6 points. A plane attractor is where every point is a fixed point. That's the definition of a plane attractor or a line attractor. So, but if you have a line attractor or a plane attractor, they require fine tuning. If you have a mechanism that tries to locate exact fixed points, and then you perturb, then you add some noise to the structure, to the connectivity, then you'll find nothing with no exact fixed point, but again, a plane, which is what functionally matters of these almost fixed.
Take a plane attractor and add some noise to it.
Yes.
Then you then the characteristic time scale of the
will be slow.
Well, you need really to fine tune it. To fine tune your perturbation if you want to keep a slow time scale.
So here I just took this.
Yeah, so I don't understand exactly what
this is. I just added, I took WIJ and just added, I just added noise to it. And I add noise and I see that eventually performance deteriorates, of course. But but before it completely deteriorates, I checked the structure, the sort of this manifold. I reconstructed the manifold again, and I saw that it looks pretty much the same. That the I can, as long as the perturbation did not destroy performance, I could also reconstruct this approximate planar factor using this technique.
So the kinetic input is perturbation.
I'm not sure it's more resistant than a planar factor. I'm just saying that's what the thing, this object that is an approximate planar factor is. You know, it's a general. It's a bend around the line of planar factor. So even if it's not exactly the line of factor or bend factor, you can still find it. That's what I'm saying.
Let me rephrase my question. So you take a planar factor. Now you add some 5% noise to the weight.
Mm-hmm.
You get something that has some flavor of the planar factor, but it's not as before.
Yes.
Now you add 3% more, and what you get now is similar to what you had previously. That's what you mean by
in a sense, I didn't start with the planar factor here. I started with an approximate. So I can't say exactly, but in a sense, if something approximate works, then something approximate plus noise is something approximate. That's what I mean. I'm saying the fact that he was not trying to locate a precise thing.
Yeah, exactly.
So this was all about learning these trained networks. Now, one thing that this poor memory performance of random networks is contrasted by better memory when you have T-forward structure. One thing that's as initial as they come, one slide that they created this morning, is can you detect a feed-forward structure in this network compared to this network? So the simplest way is to do a sure decomposition of the trained network and the untrained network, and again, the color bars are not the same, so it's hard to present in the same scale. But then the train network, there is a much larger feed-forward component. That is, the diagonal contains 2% of the power in the trained case and 20% of the power in the untrained case. So indeed, training for a specific time scale shifted towards a feed-forward structure, as would make sense from the theory. And this is just a slide I added because of Idan's talk. This is after conversation with Shimon Marom, and so here are two components, two channels. Okay, so our network now is not a network, it's a single cell, but it has many channels. It has excitatory or sodium channels, and it has inhibitory or potassium channels. And it turns out that as you do this adaptation, you vary the time of stimulus and you measure the time scale of adaptation, sodium channels change their time scale with stimulation, and potassium channels do not do that so much. But potassium channels, like inhibitory interleurons, if I'm hand-waving here, have many, many varieties and are highly affected by modulators. So this line, which is almost constant, can shift. And that would mean the intersection between them shifts. And I'm really hand-waving here, then this intersection might be another form of selecting a time scale. Because in a sense, if there's too much excitation, then you have more activity there, and then you take more time to recover. So again, far from proving, but just saying that this concept of saying that there is, that instead of taking these time scales and stretching them by virtue of having many neurons, there could be several ways of selecting time scales from those available to us from the single neuron. Okay. To conclude, both structured and random networks can solve the same task. Structured networks do it more efficiently, and the data seems to be intermediate between these two extremes. And because the data is intermediate, I was interested in reverse engineering these intermediate solutions, and it is sometimes possible to do that. And networks might be used to select timescales rather than to generate them. And thanks for Avalon Forum for the data, Larry David and Misha for the models of the raw data, and the Technion people, Nama Shimon, Ron, and Eric for discussion on timescales and other stuff. And thank you for the attention. Another frame of reference that in that it is. Exactly, because it's, you know, David would say, oh, I did 10 minus 8. Why 10 minus 8? You know, why not 10 minus? But when the resulting object defined by an arbitrary number, unfortunately, has a specific low-dimensional form, then it has a functional meaning.
So maybe I should ask differently. I'm trying to estimate what will be the shape of the region where, you know, X dot is small.
I didn't try it. I'm quite confident it will not be, because I know that in other networks where it made sense, it was a line. When you had to store one thing in memory, then this thing was a line, and when you had to store two, it was almost a plane. So I'm sure that it is related to the actual thing the network is doing. So whether it is a ball or a point, I don't know what exactly. Might be some strange faculty, I don't know.
But the eigenvalues, that if you linearize around the eigenvalues,
then are almost zero, then there you have two eigenvalues that are almost zero, and they are in the direction of the plane. And the attractive ones will exactly like you would expect from a plane of
action. So, in terms of the data which is generated, is there a difference between a quarter plane of action and just a very slow dynamics?
One has infinite memory and one has finite. But very long.
We look at an experimental simulation, you should see, you look at the combination between.
Eventually, you see that it diverges.
But
just not a. One is tuned 100%, and one is tuned 90%.